Good morning, and can I welcome members to the fifth meeting in 2016 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Can I remind everyone to switch off mobile phones and other devices should be kept on silent. We have had apologies from Mr. Arthur, who is delayed but expected to be in attendance at committee at some point this morning. First item on the agenda is decision in taking business in Pridement. Our first item today is for members to decide the consideration of the draft standing orders, rule changes and draft report on First Minister's questions and consideration of the committee's work programme and whether this should be taken in private at future meetings. Can I have your agreement to do so? Thank you very much. I move to agenda item two, which is to take evidence from Joe Fitzpatrick, MSP, Minister for Parliamentary Business, on the issue of parliamentary liaison officers. And can I welcome Minister Joe Fitzpatrick to committee this morning, as well as James Hind, Head of Cabinet, Parliament and the Governance Division, and Stephen McGregor, Head of Parliament and the Parliament and Legislation Unit in the Scottish Government. A very warm welcome to committee. Can I ask Mr. Fitzpatrick if you've any opening remarks you would like to make to
committee? I think I'm pleased to come along and speak to the committee and answer your questions.
Okay, well, I'll take opening gambit on that one, and I ask if you could really just give your description of what the Parliamentary Liaison Officer role is.
Okay, so the Parliamentary Liaison Officers were something that was devised back in the first minority government in 2007. Previously, there had been a system of ministerial aides, which had worked through the first two coalition governments. But clearly, in 2007, things had changed, and the way the Parliament was going to work had to change. So the emphasis went from supporting ministers to being a liaison with the Parliament as a whole. Clearly, for the Parliament to work and for government to make progress on any of its agenda, there had to be consensus built across the Parliament, and that's very much the main role of parliamentary liaison officers. So it's not just a link to backbench government ministers, but it's very much a link to the whole Parliament. And I think it's worked very effectively over the time.
Thank you, Minister. I think a number of members wish to have questions. Mr. Harvey, would you like to? Yeah.
Thanks very much. Good morning. I mean, I suppose for me there is that central question about the definition of the role. And you've said that you believe the role changed during a period of minority government, or the beginning of the first minority government, from supporting the minister to liaising with Parliament as a whole, not just government's own backbenchers. Now that is reflected in the answer that you gave in announcing the most recent set of changes. PLOs will assist in developing and maintaining a positive and constructive relationship between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. And in a previous answer, in announcing the first appointments of PLOs during this session, relationship between Scottish Parliament and Government, and to take account of the views of the Parliament and of Scotland as a whole. But the Ministerial Code itself, the part which hasn't been changed, is the simple definition at section 4.8 of what the role is. Appointment of an MSP as a parliamentary liaison officer to support the Cabinet Secretary in the discharge of his or her parliamentary duties. Now, there seems to be a mismatch between those two aspects. If the job is one working for the government, not of the government, but working for the government, in supporting the Cabinet Secretary, that seems to me a very different role than the one you're describing in liaising between government and Parliament as a whole. I would have to say, though, just in passing, either during the first months of this period of minority government or during the first minority government session when there was a great deal of inter-party discussion and negotiation that there had to be on a whole host of issues, yeah. I don't recall PLOs performing that function. MSPs and ministers would pick up the phone to each other.
So maybe I should refresh your memory, because in that first SNP government, I was the parliamentary liaison officer for John Swinney, and I can certainly remember having many discussions with yourself, with Sarah Boyack, and with other opposition members in terms of, obviously in that time John Swinney had four committees that he was responsible for. I sat on one of those four committees, Finance Committee, but I can certainly remember having lots of discussions specifically because I was John Swinney's PLO with yourself and with other members. Particularly one of the areas, obviously budget, lots of discussions around that. I didn't mean to say there wasn't the discussions directly with Cabinet Secretaries, but it was an additional layer which I hope it was valued, because I can certainly remember spending a lot of time in those years carrying out that role to what I thought was helpful to not just the government but to opposition members as well.
There were certainly aspects of discussion on budgets in which we would engage with not just the Cabinet Secretary or other ministers, but yourself or officials. But the principal negotiation was between the government party, the members of the government, and opposition parties. And I suppose the committee is having this look at whether the suggestion of having this role codified at some level in the standing orders is relevant to this. If the role has changed away from what's in 4.8, the ministerial code, of supporting the cabinet secretary, to one which is a go-between role, a liaison role between parliament and government, then the role is not working for the cabinet secretary, but working for all of us, and requires to be defined in the standing orders of the parliament.
It's an appointment made by the First Minister, so I think it is important to have that distinction. So it is not an appointment of the Parliament, it's an appointment made by the First Minister in discussion with myself and Cabinet Secretaries. But Parliament and the Liaison Officers, you know, the name change was about a shift of emphasis, and that was made very clear when the change from ministerial aides to parliamentary liaison officers was made, and the former First Minister made that clear, that it was very much about improved transparency, increased engagement, and you know, but clearly it's an appointment of the First Minister, not of the Parliament, and it does not in any way debar members going directly to cabinet secretaries, but you know, sometimes it's worth having different routes. I can certainly remember in the last Parliament, the work of Angus MacDonald in making sure that government understood the concerns, particularly of Labour members, in terms of the land reform bill, and understanding that, and I think as well as backbench SNP members and others, and I think that process, which Angus was very much involved in, got us to a point where we got a better bill, and it's about not just a direct communication, but understanding what it was that members were saying. So I think that over the 9 years since we've had parliamentary liaison officers, I think you'll find maybe people didn't realise that they were speaking to somebody in the capacity as a parliamentary liaison officer, and that's something which the presiding officer has spoken to me about, and now parliamentary liaison officers will declare their appointment in the chamber to improve that transparency, which I think has actually been a positive step forward, both for them and for the Parliament in terms of having that awareness. But I hope that folk have seen over the years that it's been a useful role. And if they look back, then you will actually find examples where it has helped.
I certainly welcome that last point about transparency. But in short, would you say that PLOs still, as in 4.8 of the Ministerial Code, work for ministers? Or are you saying now that PLOs work for the Parliament?
They're clearly appointed by the First Minister. So, but as part of that, in particularly in a minority government, I think the role is important, and I would hope is valued by members across the chamber.
Perhaps.
Could I bring in First Minister Johnson and then Mr. Scott? Thank you.
Thank you for the promotion, convener. Well, first of all, thank you very much for coming to the committee. I think it is useful, and I think it's an important discussion. And I'd just like to sort of continue on from some of the things you mentioned in response to Patrick Harvey. I mean, just starting, you described yourself as working for John Swinney. And that's fine. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but could you just sort of explain maybe a little bit about kind of how you would describe kind of what you were doing for the minister, and actually more broadly, kind of how PLOs help ministers.
Well, certainly, I mean, I think each PLO and cabinet secretary will have different ways of working. So I think that's one thing to be accepted. Obviously, they have to work within the confines of the ministerial code in terms of that. But, you know, when everybody does a job, they'll have their own ways of doing that and their own ways of working. So there's not a clear here's X, Y, and Z what you need to do. So it'll depend on that relationship and how people do that. But certainly when I was John Swinney's parliamentary liaison officer in 2007 to 2011, I spent a lot of time meeting with opposition, a lot of focus on budget, but also there was obviously we were looking at bringing in the climate change bill, and initially I was the only parliamentary liaison officer within John Swinney's remit, so a lot of discussions with Sarah Boyack in terms of taking that forward. We had, obviously, as a government, we would have had to build consensus in order to get that legislation through. Partway through, pretty early on in that process, Shilly-Ann Somerville came into the Parliament and took on, joined me as one of John Swinney's parliamentary liaison officers. So Shilly-Ann then focused more on the climate change area. So it would have been at that point Shilly-Ann who did more of the discussions with members in that relation. She sat on the Climate Change Committee, which Patrick chaired, and I hope you appreciated the input that Shilly-Ann was able to make. So, but, you know.
I mean, it'd be fair to say that your role was about in helping government legislation make sure that it had the support that it needed to get through.
No, always has been. Obviously, I have no idea what there was prior when it was the ministerial aides and what the role is, but it's always been a two-way process. So about understanding government process and trying government policy and trying to
find
consensus, but it's also about understanding the opposition's position as well. And I think a really good example from that in just the last parliament would have been land reform, where I think Angus MacDonald did a fantastic job of bringing together the thoughts of backbench SNP members and opposition members, particularly Labour members on the committee, and I think we managed to get to a point where I think we had a stronger bill in it. So sure. I think that shows the benefit of the system working two ways.
But those were both government bills that you've name-checked there. I mean, how much time did you spend working on members' bills and getting support from the government for those?
There's obviously far less, but I guess there'll be some Indeed. Examples where I'm trying to think what members' bills it was. We're going back quite a bit, and the reason it's easy to talk about climate change is because climate change was such a big bill, and I think it became, although it was a government-inspired bill, I think it became a being of the Parliament as a whole, and I don't think the government would claim all the credit for that bill. I think it was something which, across the chamber, we worked together, and I sure. hope that the parliamentary liaison officer system helped us get to that point where we were all proud of the legislation that was ultimately passed.
Sure. But supporting the programme for government clearly is an important part of the PLO's role.
Well, I mean, I guess supporting your manifesto commitments is something that people do from any party. So just as SNP members, whether they're PLOs or backbench, will support in the main.
But there is a difference between a manifesto and a programme for government.
And it is the same, but to the same point, members of the opposition will come in with their specific manifesto commitments or policy positions. But when you come onto a committee, I think that's where things change. And I think we've got really good examples where members of all parties have been able to somehow take off their party political hat, whether they're a PLO, whether they're a spokesperson for the opposition, and actually look at a subject. And I actually think that the committee system of this parliament does that very well. Now, clearly, if it's a government backbencher of any sort, then the type of questioning is going to be slightly different to if it's opposition. But nonetheless, I think if we look at the, certainly for the last 9 years, the robustness of questioning, whether it's from opposition or from government backbenchers, including parliamentary liaison officers, I think they've done a good job, and we can see that from the stage one reports and the changes that government often makes at stage two going through. So it's I think the parliament works really well in terms of doing that, that ability to sometimes take off a political hat and actually look at a subject straight on. And there's good examples of people from both government and opposition who've managed to do that. I could quote if you
can I ask how the parliamentary liaison officers were chosen? I mean, I'm taking it's not an accident that you've got former lawyer helping with the justice brief, a former teacher helping with the education brief. Can I just ask kind of what the process was for selecting PLOs?
The decision on selection is one for the First Minister, but obviously I helped her with that process, and also in discussion also with cabinet secretaries. So we'll have taken account of the whole range of experience that people have in order to get people who can best help in the portfolios.
And finally, I mean, I, you know, coming from a business background, I know, I think, you know, developing skills is really important. Developing talent is really important. I mean, I take it that there's an important role of this is about in terms of nurturing the backbench ranks and developing the next generation of members, you know, to take on further responsibilities. Would you say that's a part of the role?
I think everybody who comes into Parliament initially are on big learning curves. The role's about liaising with Parliament, between Parliament and government. That's what the role's about, and it's about using the, obviously as government and the same as the opposition, we have to look at our whole range of experience within our team and look at how best that can be deployed, the same way as the Labour Party will have made a decision as to which members they want to have as conveners, which members they want to have as spokespeople. And you know, that's a choice that, you know, that is made, and it's how those talents are used.
So how many members of the current ministerial ranks have formerly been PLOs?
How many? I would need to look at a list of names, but probably about a third, maybe. Probably about a third. So is it more? I don't know. I think it's about a third. But I guess we could come back to you with an answer on who's ever been a PLO, but nobody's ever been a secret PLO, so...
I don't think it's a bad thing. I mean, I think
which is actually one of the good things, because I think, and actually been dead serious about the process and the discussion that's been around here, we don't think there's ever been a problem, but we actually do think that it's always possible to be more transparent, and that's something that the First Minister is very keen to do, which is why she's made the changes that was suggested. It's, you know, about how not only are we more transparent, but people have more confidence in the systems going forward. So, you know, I hope people welcome the changes the First Minister decided to make into the ministerial code, and I hope that outside that gives folk more confidence in the processes we have in this Parliament, because I think our system is really, really good. I would hate to think we ever end up having to go down the system of Westminster, where we have an unelected House trying to determine what happens in our legislation. So I think we have a robust system, but it is appropriate that we do keep checking that and seeing if we can make it more transparent. And so obviously the First Minister made the changes to the ministerial code on that basis, and after discussion with the presiding officer, we've also asked parliamentary liaison officers to indicate their positions prior to asking a question of their cabinet secretary.
Well, I think we can agree that transparency and confidence is vital. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Scott?
Thank you very much. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming to speak to us today. Can I just go back to Patrick Harvey's point? And of course, I welcome First Minister's determination to introduce even greater transparency into this process. But I'm still unclear as to... I'm still trying to bottom out what the difference between your statement and the difference in standing orders. If the PLOs are working for the Parliament, then this is, as you implied, this is new, given that their appointment is by the First Officer, the First Minister. Because normally when people are working for the Parliament, which is, there are two entities, very real entities, of course, I don't need to tell you, but for those looking in, shall we say, in the Parliament and the government are two very separate entities. And normally those working for the Parliament are appointed by the corporate body or the presiding officer, with endorsement perhaps of the Bureau. But I can't reconcile in my own mind how, given the standing orders and the fact that these PLOs have to work within the standing orders, that they are now working for the Parliament as well, as you have implied.
I think there's a conflict there. No, I think, let me be clear, parliamentary liaison officers are appointed by the First Minister. Their role, I think, is of benefit to the whole Parliament. But clearly, we all work for the people of Scotland, whether we're MSPs. So that's ultimately where our responsibility all lies is to the people of Scotland. So I think it was an interpretation. I'm suggesting that they actually work for the Parliament. I don't think that's quite fair. I think they're appointed by the First Minister to do a role which I think is clearly of benefit to the Parliament. And because I think particularly in a minority Parliament, if we're going to make any progress on any issues, there has to be consensus. There has to be liaison, there has to be discussion. So it's that the focus is absolutely on that liaison role. And I think, you know, we've got a group of I think all the PLOs are new to those roles, so they'll be developing those roles going forward. And I hope that once they're in position for a period of time, members will see the benefit that those positions have had.
Of benefit to the Parliament rather than of benefit to the government.
I think it's a benefit to the people of Scotland is ultimately the most important.
I would rather you were clearer on that. I mean, we're all here for the benefit of the people of Scotland, yeah. But we all have different points of view.
Well, they are appointed by the First Minister. But I think it will be a benefit to Parliament, but I also think it will be a benefit to the government. I'm not seeing a discussion there. I don't see why you can be one or just the other.
Okay. I just on a quite specific point, and elsewhere in other parliaments, there are restrictions on questions that PLOs can ask of their own cabinet secretary or minister. And I just wonder if you would consider the value of that. I think you said earlier that the questioning by PLOs of their cabinet secretaries had been in the past neutral. I've certainly witnessed questions which are just, here's a feed for an inspired question, shall we say, which is absolutely legitimate. But I just can't quite get round my head this suggestion that PLOs are also there to scrutinise the government, yet... which you're suggesting by their role in committee and therefore the Parliament, which is also to provide scrutiny of government, and yet they're also they're bound by the standing orders to be working for their cabinet secretary.
So the big difference with other legislatures where PLOs are not allowed to ask questions of the cabinet secretaries is that within the ministerial code, they are expressly bound to support the government position, effectively covered by collective responsibility. So the old code from pre-2008, when we had ministerial aides, made it very clear in the position that was the case, that they had to go further than the usual following the whip. The specific line was, the position as ministerial parliament aides means they must support the executive on key policy issues. And so that's why in any time in pre-2007, when a ministerial parliamentary aide was wanting to take a different view, whether on committee or in the chamber, they would resign from that position. That was removed from the code, and I think that's a very significant removal, because first and foremost, PLOs are MSPs, and that's why I think it would be wrong of the Parliament to come up with a situation where a set of backbench MSPs were not allowed to ask questions. I think the discussions that we've had, I think at the behest of Deputy Convener, with the PO to make that process more transparent, so that if a PLO is asking a question, then people know it's the PLO that's asking the question, so that if people want to put any colouring on that, they can do, it's probably helpful. So that, but that's about transparency. And we've seen that because I've seen a few articles in the paper where some journalists have said that was a softball question or whatever. And I guess that shows that the system's working in terms of the transparency. Now, government backbenchers are always going to get accused of softball questions, and opposition are going to get accused of highly politicised questions. That's the way of Parliament. That's the way of Parliament. But I guess what I hope is that by the changes that we've made, and you know, maybe there's a bit of time to see how all this works out going forward, but hopefully the change we've made has got us to the position where there is considerably, there's an increase in transparency, so that even if people think that's a softball question, well, from a PLO, well, they know that, so there's no secrecy around the system, which I think is one of the strengths of our Parliament, is that as the Parliament has grown over the years, whereas other places have perhaps closed in, we've become more open and more transparent, and I always think that's a good thing.
I suppose it's this extension of the role beyond the standing orders, which you seem to be implying. And it would be far clearer cut if we knew that PLOs were just working for cabinet secretaries. They were part of the government for the government, and there it was.
But that's
and they
not
would
the
ask
case.
Softball questions.
That is not the case.
But you're saying that they're working for the Parliament, and for the Parliament...
No, I did not say that either. I say they're MSPs.
Well, you define the extension of the role again for me, for the avoidance of doubt.
I think just to be clear, again, Parliament liaison officers are appointed by the First Minister. Their role, I believe, benefits government and benefits the Parliament. And I would hope people who've had experience in the Parliament will have, and Patrick in particular, will have, actually, if you look back, will have appreciated that that role has been a positive role and helpful.
Sandra, there's a number of members that haven't been in yet. I'll bring you in later on, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Minister, going back to the role of the PLO, obviously they require to have access to information. That information may be prohibited. That information may be confidential at time, or the nature of it may be confidential. So can I just get in my mind about what they can do with that information? Do they receive any training in the role? Is there any sort of process that they all go through, or do cabinet ministers and secretaries themselves try to assimilate and do roles for themselves? And what real scrutiny and governance do they have themselves in that role should they be challenged?
So, as I said earlier, the working relationships of and the ways of working of individual PLOs and cabinet secretaries will vary, but it always has to be within the ministerial code. However, when appointed by the First Minister, the PLOs all receive a letter. So maybe if I could read out the specific, it's a specific paragraph which relates to the area. So all the PLOs receive a letter, which and it's. Says, this role will involve you in having to access government information. Such access will be solely for the purpose of allowing you to discharge your role effectively and on a strictly confidential basis. You'll also have access, and I think this is importantly because it's the other side of it, you'll also have access to information provided in confidence as a result of your parliamentary role, for example, in relation to committee membership. And so when a member of a committee receives an in-confidence paper, that's kind of referring to. It would therefore be important that you respect the confidentiality arrangements that exist in respect of both roles and avoid any conflict of interest or the appearance of such a conflict. So the potential for a conflict is recognised, and it's highlighted to PLOs that they have a responsibility to any information that they receive from government to respect that confidentially, and also likewise any information they receive in other capacities to respect that equally. And I think that's something that members do. So a spokesperson for a party has to respect what information they get from a committee just the same as PLOs do.
And as I say, do they receive any formal training, or is that just an accepted rule that they'd be supported by their cabinet secretary, or they'd be supported by the ministerial's office?
Yeah, I mean, I think the point is to, and I'm not sure what training you would need to understand that if you've received something in confidence, you don't.
But in, just to do the role, because as I say, there are obviously information that disseminate and how that role has expanded, because obviously it's changed in some ways. We've discussed that already from what it was originally. So, and it may adapt as you go forward. Obviously, the First Minister makes the appointment. We acknowledge that. But each individual, when they're working with the Cabinet Secretary, will have an opportunity to develop their potential as well, so that they may end up becoming a minister in the future.
No formal PLO training
of that kind.
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I bring in Ms. Hawkey?
I'd like to thank the Minister for coming along today. Thank you. I am one of those who is on that steep learning curve that you were alluding to earlier. So it's been really helpful for me to hear what you've been saying about the history of the role and how it's developed. So I wonder, what would be lost if we didn't have PLOs in Parliament?
I think the role is helpful. So I think it might be more difficult for us to make some of the progress we've made in some times. I think you'd always find a way. But I think the focus that the PLOs have on a portfolio area to try and understand the thoughts of other members, I think it would be a negative if we didn't have that role. I think it's helpful, particularly in minority government. But I think there's good examples in the last parliament as well, where PLOs made a particular contribution to get into a place where the parliament was comfortable with the legislation. So even when the government could, if it wanted to, bulldoze something through, that didn't happen. And
would you be able to expand a little bit on that sort of liaison role and how you see that?
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things that I think would be lost would be the ability to, obviously meetings can happen and some people can put out a press release to say here's a position, but sometimes it's what's behind that. So it's not just understanding what a position is, but understanding why that position is that would then help government develop policies. So some of the amendments that came forward in the land reform bill were challenging for us to find ways to bring forward those amendments, and government had to work very hard in order to achieve that. We wouldn't have achieved it if there hadn't been an understanding of what it was that the members were concerned about, and I think in that particular role the PLO was very helpful in making sure that not only did we hear, but we understood what the issues were.
Okay, Mr. Johnson, did you want back in?
Yeah. Just a brief supplementary. You've a number of times sort of set out the benefits of the role, and I accept those benefits. I accept there's a benefit to having a Scottish Parliament. I think there's a benefit to having a Scottish Government. It doesn't also necessarily mean that I agree with its objectives and purpose. Do you accept that there's a difference between saying that there's a benefit to having a role and the objectives and the purpose that role may in any given time be serving?
I'm not 100% understanding the question, I don't think. But
there's a benefit to having a First Minister, mm-hmm. and it's very easy for me to say that. Being a Labour member, I won't necessarily always think that the SN and having an SNP First Minister will achieve the purposes that I would want, even if I can accept the wider benefit of the role. Do you understand the distinction?
I'd be surprised if the First Minister was going to appoint a member of another party to as a parliamentary liaison officer. But I think there's always going to be that difference. But I do think there will be a number of members, current and past, who will be able to reflect on opposition parties, who will be able to reflect on occasions when that they will have felt the benefit of the parliamentary liaison officer.
But it's fundamentally about That's a benefit, but the objectives are still those of the government primarily that they pursue.
Well, I'm going to stick with the land reform legislation. Our objective was to get the best possible legislation, and I think the process there in terms of liaising with, I guess, like-minded in that, you know, whether it was the Green Party, Labour Party, the objective was to get in the same direction, and it was how we got there, and I think we got further along that road than we might have done if it hadn't been for those discussions and those liaisons. I think particularly the members of that committee engaged in that in a constructive way. Sometimes that involved direct discussion with ministers, sometimes it was indirect using liaison officers.
So,
Sorry, Mr. Scott, I've got a question myself, and then Mr. Harvey, and then I'll come back to you. Minister, you mentioned there that it would be unlikely in a minority situation the First Minister would appoint a PLO from another party, but it's quite possible in a coalition that there would be PLOs from the both or however many parties
I would have imagined that if there were a coalition, this is quite hypothetical, but my guess is if there was a coalition government, then given that the First Minister discusses and confirms appointments with the Cabinet Secretaries, it's likely that the Parliamentary Liaison Officers would be of the same party as the Cabinet Secretary. I think that's
okay. Thank you, Minister. Mr. Harvey?
Just a couple of points to follow up from the discussion so far. Quickly, firstly, on collective responsibility, you've stated quite clearly that PLOs are not bound by collective responsibility in the way that PPSs at Westminster are. So presumably, that being the case, a PLO would not be dismissed or be expected to resign for voting against the government whip.
That's correct. I mean, clearly they're bound by the same discipline that we are all bound by in terms of the whip's process and party discipline, but there's no extra layer.
But it wouldn't
in the way
affect
that
their PLO role.
There's no extra in the way that there is for clearly a minister is bound by collective responsibility. That does not apply to parliamentary.
And how often have PLOs voted against the whip?
It's not something I've ever assessed in any way. And
okay.
I think
it's not something
I
recall.
No, I don't know. And I think that would probably apply to most Green members who've never broken the Green whip. But the fact is that people join parties because they have similar views. And so in the main, people are going to come to the same conclusions on those views. So whether it's members of the Conservative Party, members of the Green Party, members of the Labour Party, or members of the SNP, they've joined those parties because in the main, they have agreed on most things.
Yeah. No, nobody tended to spot the days when Robin and I voted different ways. But let's leave that aside. I think the situation that we've got here is, I don't detect any hostility to the existence of PLOs, not even any great rejection of the description you've given of the way government has perceived the role to change over the years. But I do think it seems quite clear that there has been not always good understanding between government and Parliament about those changes. Government has had a sense of how the role is changing, but that hasn't always been apparent to Parliament. I think you gave a good example with the climate change bill, for example, where as committee convener, I respected and valued the role of all committee members equally, and I always perceived the members acting as committee members. When committees want to hear from government, we invite ministers and civil servants to come and give evidence. And I would not have been, I would not have felt it appropriate if a member of the committee had been effectively acting on the government's behalf during that process. And there's been an acknowledgement, and I welcome it, that that was inappropriate for PLOs to be sitting on their own ministers' committees. And that's a positive change. But I would just suggest that there needs to be, if this role has changed from one working for ministers to one that is engaging both with how government conducts its functions and engaging with how Parliament conducts its functions, there does need to be some mutually agreeable definition rather than government only defining this through the ministerial code. So can I just ask, would the government seek to oppose an introduction of a definition into standing orders so that there is some mutual agreement about how the role is supposed to work?
I think it would be very difficult for what is an appointment of the First Minister to be governed by standing orders. I think that would be quite strange.
Aspect of the way ministers do their job are defined by standing orders.
I think that would be quite difficult. I mean, the main role of PLOs is as backbench, as MSPs. So I think that would be quite strange. However, that said, it's not impossible for us to have, a lot of what goes on in the Parliament is not in standing orders and it's in agreed ways forward. So in response to the request for increased transparency, First Minister has and confidence in the system as well. I think that's the other thing. It's about how we get to. We want to make sure that it's important for government as it is for the Parliament that people have confidence in our systems and our democracy. So that on that basis, the First Minister has put into the Ministerial Code that PLOs won't be on the committee most relevant to their cabinet secretaries. We have also made sure that at each point there's transparency over who the PLOs are, and that's something that First Minister will be clear that we do that at the earliest opportunity going forward. And in addition, with discussion from with the PO, we've agreed that they would at each point a new appointment would make a statement in the chamber prior to questioning their cabinet secretary. So I think we've gone some way to hopefully alleviate the concerns, and I just hope that we could give it that some time to see how that works. I mean, all the PLOs are relatively new in post. We have got some new systems in place which I think benefits the PLOs as well as the Parliament. So the increased transparency, I think the point you're making about people having a better understanding of what PLOs do, I think that's a good thing for the PLOs as well, because maybe there was a lack of recognition of their role and the work that they were doing.
But you accept the general argument that the previous role was about how ministers carry out their duties. Mm-hmm. Now you're saying this is about both how government functions and how Parliament functions. And that being the case, there needs to be a mutual understanding of what the role is and how
it
operates.
And I think this process is part of developing that understanding. But ultimately, this is appointments of the First Minister, and it would be strange if we start and having the PLOs don't exist, and they don't have any special rights in the Parliament. So it would be very strange if you're having standing orders that would require
You have acknowledged that they have a special role in relation to the relationship between government and Parliament that other
government and backbenchers
have.
Yeah. But
okay, Mr. Scott.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, just I'm still trying to bottom this out in terms of this new role of PLOs, and you on two occasions suggested that Angus MacDonald. Job in the Iraqi committee was to understand the mood of other parliamentarians other than his own party, rather than to influence. And if the new role is, as you said twice, I think, to understand and benefit the progress of bills, then I just would like you to confirm that is, in fact, a new role to understand rather than to influence, but also, and perhaps, and following on from what the Deputy Convener, Patrick Harvey, has just said, I appreciate the difficulty and perhaps the nuances around this, but would you or the First Minister perhaps like to write to this committee perhaps after reflection with your officials and others to really give us a clearer definition, because I'm still struggling to grasp what this new role is of PLOs and the apparent conflict between what you've said and what the standing orders tell us.
So the big difference and the big change was the focus on liaison, but clearly they're still appointed by the First Minister and they're still working with the Cabinet Secretary. So it's to serve as a liaison officer to a particular Cabinet Secretary. So,
DPLR committee. So, I'm interested in this nuance. Working for the Cabinet.
Well, they're appointed
Secretary.
To serve. There was a specific language. is, I'm pleased to confirm your appointment as Parliamentary Liaison Officer in support of Cabinet Secretary and Portfolio Minister. So that's the language. But in that role, and in taking forward that role, the most important thing is that liaison. It's only part of what they're doing, of course. And different parliamentary liaison officers, different cabinet secretaries will have different ways of doing that, but always bound by the ministerial code, which mm-hmm. we've now updated in a way that I hope.
Well, I still can't get beyond from what you've said and the standing orders and what you've said today. There's a clear conflict of interest, and perhaps you could write to us and redefine and how that...
Well, we'll have a think if we can find some words that make that clearer.
I wonder if the Minister would be willing to share the appointment letter with the committee.
Yeah, I think that's...
That would be helpful. Thank you. Are there any further questions from members? Mr. Johnson?
Just finally, we have a unicameral system, a parliamentary system, so we don't have the clear distinction between government and parliament that other places might have. But would you agree with me that the closer an MSP is to the government, the more difficult that scrutiny role becomes, the further the separation, the easier it is to perform that scrutiny role?
I think whatever the scrutiny is happening has to reflect and respect the voting pattern of the people of Scotland. So in the last parliament, clearly the majority of MSPs in this parliament were government members, were members of the SNP. In this parliament, that's not the case. But I think that, as I've said before, there are some very good examples of people who were her PLOs scrutinising the cabinet secretary that they have been appointed to serve. One example, I'm going to try and stick away from SNP members now. John Finney, when John Finney was a member of the SNP group, he was the parliamentary liaison officer for Kenny McCaskill. And I think if anybody cares to look at the record, they will see lots of occasions where John Finney has robustly questioned Kenny McCaskill on justice issues. But the challenge then is for all of us in our roles to particularly when on committee to put aside to some extent the party hat, whatever that hat is, whether it's as a parliamentary liaison officer, whether it's as a spokesperson for a particular party where you're bound to support the manifesto commitments or the policies of the party, to take that off to some extent, so you are actually scrutinising whatever it is that comes before you, whether that's evidence from external parties or whether that's a government bill.
Okay.
I think most folk manage to do that really well.
I take it you think it's a good thing that ministers can't question or don't question their fellow ministers in Parliament. Or sit on committees. Do you think that's a good thing?
Well, ministers are bound by collective responsibility. PLOs are not bound by collective responsibility, and I think that's the.
But you see the benefit to not permitting that in Parliament.
It's not relevant to this area because, and I know I think there's an attempt here, but ministers are bound by collective responsibility, and when they're appointed and accept appointments, they accept. Collective responsibility. Parliamentary liaison officers are not bound by collective responsibility. However, in other places, they are effectively bound by collective responsibility.
But so already, the big difference. Their objectives are set. They're appointed by minister. Their objectives are set by ministers. They report to minister. All of these things that you get access to government information, which is confidential. So. And I think we've already established that there is at least some connection between their status and role as a PLO and potential future progression within the government. There's clearly a proximity, would you not agree, between PLOs and the government that an ordinary backbench doesn't have.
Well, it's an appointment by the First Minister.
And so if the relationship between a minister and the government means that it's not appropriate for them to be questioning, surely that certainly raises the question of the PLO. I think your sort of dismissal of that point, I think, is maybe a little quick, may I suggest?
I'm merely stating the fact that ministers are bound by collective responsibility. Parliamentary liaison officers are not, and that is it's a substantial and pretty fundamental difference. I think transparency is something that's really important. So there's a question of when an opposition spokesperson asks a question, should people know that, you know? So there, I think there's lots of ways that we can improve transparency, but I don't think it would be right to suggest that we effectively have a set of second-class backbench MSPs who are not allowed to ask questions and not allowed to represent their constituents in the way that other people are. But
I think the question is whether or not we've got a rank of government that has having a different set of rules applied to other ranks of the government. That's the distinction.
No, your point is wrong in suggesting that PLOs are a rank of government, because that's just wrong.
So there's no connection between PLOs and government?
There's connections. There's lots of connections all over. Clearly, any SNP member is going to be closer to government than a member of the Conservative Party, for instance, who I would suggest are perhaps furthest away.
A letter means there's a formal relationship between government and PLO, surely.
It's an appointment from the...
It's a formal relationship.
It's an appointment from the First Minister.
It's a formal relationship.
And, you know, that's... There's no secrecy here. I think that's the important...
But that is a status, isn't it? It's a formal relationship between government...
It's an appointment of the First Minister.
Which is a formal relationship.
We'll leave it there. Points well made, Mr. Johnson. Can I bring in Mr. Arthur and then Mr. Scott?
First, I would just like to apologise for being a bit late in attending due to unforeseen circumstances. Also, just for the record, I will declare that I am a Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, prior to which I was Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for Health. And also, just to correct Mr. Johnson, my background is not in law, but in music. Obviously, given my kind of experience of being a PLO, as limited as it is in the last 4 months, my understanding of it has been, and in considering international practice of it, the role, if carried out properly, is to develop expertise in a particular portfolio, to engage in liaison, not just with parliamentarians, but to make particular efforts to engage with people out with Parliament, and ultimately to act as a conduit between members of all parties and indeed the Cabinet Secretary and ministers. Is this a characterisation that the Minister would agree with? I'd be keen to hear his views on that.
You know, I think that's true. I think in the main today we've talked mainly about the parliamentary role, but clearly there are other roles as well in terms of helping the Cabinet Secretary hear the voice of wider Scotland. Obviously, there is limited time that anybody has in terms of for engagement. So while here in the Parliament, Cabinet Secretaries try and make themselves as available as possible, equally in wider Scotland, there is a role there as well. But as I say, it will vary from PLO and Cabinet Secretary to PLO and Cabinet Secretary as to how those functions are ultimately.
Yeah. So one of the things that strikes me is this sort of inbuilt flexibility, which is necessary as ultimately different Cabinet Secretaries are going to have a sort of different modus operandi. But while respecting that flexibility and the right of Cabinet Secretaries to have their own unique relationship with a PLO, what has been suggestions that from the Deputy Convener this role could be formalised within standing orders. You have raised a particular conflict here because it's an appointment from the First Minister. Would there be perhaps an opportunity within the ministerial code to perhaps expand upon the definition of a PLO, but in such a way that doesn't overly restrict it?
Obviously, the ministerial code is a matter for the First Minister, mm-hmm. but I'm sure she'll be listening to the proceedings today, and if there's any thoughts on requirement for further adjustments, then I'm sure that's something she'll take into account. I guess what I hope is that members will appreciate that there's been some significant changes. There's a new team of PLOs, and you know, I would hope that the committee would feel it's appropriate to allow that process to bed in, and you know, if there's a feeling there's a need to come back and have further discussions going forward, then I think that would not be a bad thing, because I actually think today's discussion has been helpful in highlighting the role and maybe increasing understanding of those roles across the Parliament more, which I think is good for members, and I also think it'll be helpful to our PLOs.
Convener, just to take you back to what you said about Mr. Finney's contribution to scrutiny of his cabinet secretary, I don't recall that necessarily being welcome, but are you telling us that, in good faith, I dare say, that the role of the new role of the PLOs would be also a scrutiny role, and in which case that would stack up with you telling us that they are working for the Parliament, because the Parliament exists to allow, in a democracy, scrutiny of the government process. So if you are going to perhaps write to us in that regard, will you put that in, that this will also be a welcome part of the PLO's role, that they will be welcome to scrutiny and
so when John Finney was questioning Kenny McCaskill, he would not have been questioning Kenny McCaskill as the PLO. He'll have swapped his hat back and he will have been questioning Kenny McCaskill as the member for Highlands and Islands. And I think that is something that, in this Parliament, I think members are actually very good at, is having two roles. And, you know, I've seen a number of party spokespeople sit on committees, and clearly sometimes they will come into that committee wearing their party hat because it's a policy which is, it was in their manifesto and they have a clear policy. So, for instance, in the last Parliament, Alison McInnes would have stood rigidly on anything about the creation of Police Scotland because the Lib Dems' position was very clear against what we were proposing. But on a whole load of other issues, Alison was able to take the fact that she was the Lib Dem justice spokesperson hat off and look at the evidence and as a committee member, and I think our committee members of all parties are actually very good at being able to do that in most cases. There's almost going to be one or two things where people have very rigid views, and at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what, and somebody comes to give evidence, Patrick's view on fracking is not going to change. There'll be examples of that across the parties. But in the main, I think people members who serve on committees do a really good job. They listen to the evidence, which is really important for this Parliament, because one of the strengths of the committee system is the time that is made to hear from out with the Parliament in scrutinising government bills or other matters. So I think everybody has to have that skill of being able to wear two hats sometimes, and it's specifically referenced in the letter that PLOs received from the First Minister.
I do accept that, and I think people work very hard to wear two hats, as it were, at the one time and with integrity. But I would also ask you to acknowledge that there is a potential here for the perception, at any rate, of a conflict of interest in the role that you're assigning to PLOs. And the perception, as you know, is sometimes more awkward than the reality. I don't doubt that people of integrity do, and Alison McInnes is a classic case in point, universally recognised in this Parliament, of some absolute integrity in that regard, historically. But I just think you're asking an awful lot of, in this case, your PLOs, who are mostly, if my memory serves me correctly, newcomers to our Parliament, welcome newcomers, of course, but you're asking a lot of them in this regard to tread that very, very fine line between the perception and the reality of the standing orders, the First Minister's appointment, and telling us also that they have the ability, when they want, and indeed they should, scrutinise their Cabinet Secretary as and when appropriate, and hold them to account. I just think that's a big task you're setting these people.
You may be right. I think they're up to it. For the last 9 years, I don't think there's been any examples of where I think there's good evidence of PLOs managing to do that just as well as spokespeople from other parties have managed to do that. And so I hope that continues.
For the record, I think it's worth all of us acknowledging that none of this discussion should be seen as casting aspersions on individuals or the way that they've done their job. But I think there is a critical difference between someone having a role on behalf of a political party and a role working for a minister. The purpose of Parliament's existence is to hold government to account, regardless of which party is in office. The purpose of Parliament is to hold government to account, not to hold opposition parties to account. And there is a danger that rather than walking the line becomes blurred.
Hopefully the changes that we've made in terms of, and it's about perception as Mr Scott indicated, of adding to the ministerial code that PLOs will not sit on the committee of the Cabinet Secretary makes that line sharper, and also the increased transparency in terms of when questions are asked in chamber. So hopefully those two things together will help unblur the line, so to speak. But as I say, if members feel that going forward there's a need for more discussion on these matters, I'd be happy to have
that's
to
helpful.
Back.
But, thank you.
Thank you to members, and can I just say thank you to Mr. Fitzpatrick for attending this morning and to his officials, and we will now move into private session and allow the press and public to leave. Thank you very much. Thank you.